A large-scale map can be really useful for people to orient the location of your project. To retain the attention of your audience, I recommend keeping the displayed information to a bare minimum. We can get away with very little software in creating this map. For downloading the satellite image in high resolution, we will use Google Earth Pro, which is free. We will later edit the image in Photoshop, but if you are a free user, there are other alternatives like GIMP or Figma for editing. To get started, open Google Earth Pro for desktop. Search for the region of your project. To reduce clutter on the image, we will remove all labels in the sidebar. By the way, you can hide the sidebar to get a wider image. To ensure there are no weird tilts or rotations, go to View, Reset, Tilt and Compass. This will give you a perfect top north projection. Click the little image icon to display the save image settings. I recommend to remove all labels again. Choose the highest resolution and click Save Image. You might notice that some information like area markings will not be displayed in the desktop version of Google Earth, so we will have to open it in a web browser instead. Luckily, there is a direct link for that purpose. Simply click the blue ball icon on the top. You can search for anything you want, like a specific area, to display the borderline. Again, click the little compass icon to ensure the image is aligned with north. The web version of Google Earth does not allow you to save high-res images, so we will have to make a screenshot. Congratulations, your map is almost done. It just needs some finishing touches. Let's open the high-res image in Photoshop. Make sure the layer is unlocked. Click Command 0 to zoom to fit the viewport size. We will use a layer mask to keep our workflow non-destructive and draw the masked area using the ellipse tool. Hold down Shift Option to lock the ratio and draw from the middle. Release the mouse button when you are happy with the size. Use Command T to enter transform mode so you can adjust the position of the circle. To make a selection, Command click on the layer, select the image layer, and click on the little mask icon on the bottom toolbar. Now you can remove the circle layer, or even better, let it be your outer stroke by adjusting some properties. For a final touch, select the crop tool and set the ratio to 1:1. You can center the crop by dragging the image with your cursor and hit enter to confirm. You might want to set the background color for your image. To do so, create a new layer by clicking the plus icon. Make sure the layer is on the bottom. Right-click on the layer and choose solid color. You can set it to any color. I'm going with paper white. Most maps will have some flaws like overlapping and extreme pixelation if you have any water in your image. A really great way to fix this issue is to pull up the Magic Selection tool and make a selection of the area. With your selection, hit Command plus J to make a duplicate of that selection. You might notice that we didn't keep the mask from our original layer, so you want to Command click the layer mask again and apply the mask for the new layer as well. We want to give the water an average color, and to do so, select the Paint Bucket tool and Option click to eyedrop any area of the water. Click a few times to apply that color to the current layer. We want to fill the whole area. Great, now the pixelation is gone, but the water looks a little flat. There is a special texture that will make anything look like water. Go to Filter, Styles, Oil Painting. You can adjust the settings to make it look more like water ripples. You want to repeat the action for all the water areas, and to keep things tidy, select the layers, right-click and choose Merge Layers to fuse them all together in one. The map overlap issue is a little more difficult to solve. It is a good practice to work on a duplicate layer. In this case, we have a darker part on our image, so the first thing we can try is painting with the dodge tool, which allows us to brighten up parts of the image while retaining saturation. To take care of the line, we can use the clone tool, which will copy a part of the image to your brush when painting. To select the reference area, option click anywhere on the image layer. A good tip here is to clone from more than one nearby spot to make the cloning less obvious. Repeat the action until your overlap is no longer visible. We can turn on and off the layer to see the before and after. The map is complete, but we need some visuals to make it more interesting. We will use the browser screenshot as a reference for our area border. Simply drag and drop the image into your Photoshop file. Reduce the opacity to something like 80% and press Command T to adjust the size and position. Remember to hold down Shift when resizing, not to screw up the ratio. Press Enter when the images line up. To make things easier when you work, you can set a border to the image to separate it from the background. To do so, right-click the layer and choose Blending option. options, turn on the stroke option to get a nice border around your layer. A really good tool for vector drawing is the pen tool. Make sure it's drawing a shape and not a path, and set a border color and thickness. We will click along the reference border to draw out our shape. To move around the viewport, you can activate pan mode by using the space bar. When you are back on the starting point, simply click it to complete the shape. If you want a dashed stroke, you can click in the pen options and choose dashed. You might want to fill the area with some kind of transparent color, but simply selecting a fill color will not do the trick. In order to control the opacity of the fill, duplicate the layer and move it underneath the border layer. Now you have one layer for the border and another for the fill. This lets us control the opacity of the fill layer to something like 20%. Fiddle around with the different colors and line settings until you are happy. If you're like me, you probably want to name your area. To do that, select the text tool and start typing. You can change font and size. I will make the color white. However, the readability is really poor, but we can fix that by drawing a black rectangle and placing it underneath the text layer. Adjust the rectangle size with transform and group the layers to make them easier to control. To move both layers, select the group and Command T to transform and move it in position. Perfect, your map is ready for exporting. We usually want to export for either print or screen. For print, we want to maximize resolution, so choose Save a Copy and use TIFF, which will keep the image uncompressed. You can safely deselect the Layers option, as there will be no need to edit this image. For screens, you want to minimize the size without destroying readability. Your best option will be to export for web, and I find JPEG High as a really good option. You can also save some bytes by reducing the pixel count if it will be viewed for something like mobile. The image size is really substantial, but on the side-by-side, you really don't see that much difference. When looking at the image after exporting, I noticed it looked a little dark, so I just wanted to show you one small adjustment that can make a huge difference on any map or image. Go to the image layer, click on the adjustment icon, and select color balance. Let's make the map a little greener and a little cooler by adjusting the sliders. Lastly, we want to adjust levels, which lets you manipulate the value range of the image. By sharpening the range a little, we get a more punchy contrast, and moving the middle slider will brighten or darken the overall image. That's it. I hope you learned something new. See you next time.